gateway to the west. Likewise, the St. Louis Arena has been a symbol for indoor soccer that has been played here for better than a decade. The Steamers were so successful for many years, led by high-scoring players like Tony Glavine and Don Ebert, and they frequently led the league in attendance. But now it's a new age in St. Louis. The Storm, they'll take on San Diego tonight. Presents the Major Soccer League Game of the Week. Today's game is being brought to you by Budweiser, the king of beers, with that distinctively clean, crisp, cold taste. Nothing beats the Bud. By Mars Milky Way Bar, enjoy the smooth chocolate and caramel taste of the original smoothie. And by Adidas Equipment, everything that is essential and nothing that is not. This is the arena in St. Louis where the Storm were 20-6 during the regular season. They'll need to win today against San Diego in this key playoff game, or else the Storm season will end and then San Diego would go on to the championship. Welcome everyone to St. Louis. I'm John Paul Della Camera. During the regular season, you couldn't ask for a better matchup. Each team won four games. In fact, each team won twice in the other team's building. But Ty Keogh, as we look at the first four games of the series, we can tell that injuries have really hurt the Storm in the playoffs.
Injuries have hurt the St. Louis Storm, and they're looking for depth right now that they can't find. If you look at game one, where Zoltan Toth broke four ribs, the starting goalkeeper for the Storm, and had a stellar year all along, they're without him now. Then in game two, again in San Diego, the San Diego Sockers were able to prevail 5-4, and we get to game three. It's in St. Louis, and St. Louis, in really an inspiring performance, a courageous game, came back to make the series 2-1. And up through game three, the home field advantage had held true. But in game four, San Diego scored seven unanswered goals in the last 16 minutes of the game and just tore apart the St. Louis Storm.
San Diego is a team used to winning. They've won five out of the last six division championships. And one of the reasons, I tell you, if you talk to any player on both sides of the field, they'll tell you the key player is Brian Quinn.
Brian Quinn with his one-touch passing, and he's just a spiritual leader for the team. He makes all the players around him a better player, and he also, with his tackling, his stalwart tackling in midfield, really changes the game for his team.
On the opposite side, they've had a dynamic duo with the Storm, but one player you see and is out, that means more of the load must fall on Preki's shoulders.
Well, Preki has been the leading offensive threat in this league over the last four or five seasons, but there's a lot of weight to carry. As you mentioned, he's got a vicious left-footed shot, and he's a very good one-on-one player. He can beat two or three, so he'll have to do a lot of damage tonight to keep St. Louis in the game.
And the Storm have got to get their spirits high. They were down quite a bit after losing 11-4 on Thursday. We'll have game five up next from St. Louis. To the arena in St. Louis where San Diego leads it by 3-1. We have not only great players in this game today, but also two of the all-time great coaches in Ron Newman of the San Diego Sockers and Don Popovic. Between these two coaches, they have won 10 out of 12 major soccer league titles. We talked to both coaches, Ron Newman first, about tonight's game.
Well, Ty, of course, St. Louis are sitting on a knife edge. As you say, we've got a wonderful chance to go through. I think that mental composure is probably going to be the key factor. There's going to be a lot of endeavor from both teams. So who can stay mentally okay, I think, will be the winner.
Well, it's definitely might be our last home game, and we need a victory because of our fans in the city of St. Louis, and we want respect for ourselves, and we know we have all kind of injuries and everything, but we don't want to use that as an excuse, so it will be very nice if we can win it today.
Ty Keogh, your thoughts on their thoughts?
Well, I really think it just comes down to one thing. For the St. Louis Storm, there's no tomorrow. They have to win tonight or the season's over. The San Diego Sockers have a little bit of a cushion. Will it affect their play mentally? As Ron Newman mentioned, we'll have to see.
Right now, we'll take this timeout and pause for this regional break. Game five coming up next. You're watching the Major Soccer League playoffs on Sports Channel America. We've got almost 2 minutes in the first quarter, and it's scoreless from St. Louis. Hermes cutting it right side. Kevin Crowe has had another sensational year, the only three-time defender of the year in a major soccer league. Paul Wright picked up by DeFlorio. Wright slow, plays it in and a score to Guevara. Paul Wright lulled the Storm to sleep.
You have to respect Paul Wright's abilities one-on-one so much that you're afraid to get close enough to him. When you're not close enough to him, he then can look up and find an open man, and that time he found Guevara. But in the first three games of this series, the team that scored first ended up losing. We see Paul Wright. Time and space he has to find Guevara, who streaked across the box, and Durant was right with him, but he managed to get that early touch in on it. We'll see it from the other angle, from behind the goal. It splits the St. Louis defense. Guevara's there. He touches it first time. If he tries to collect it, Durant's close enough to him, but by hitting it first time, he gets it past Ilievski.
Back in the live action at 2:16, it is Guevara's first playoff goal. Paul Wright had the assist, and now St. Louis down 1-0. Donegan with a pass on the left side. Just missed. Ingram holding it. Back to Preki. I think Kevin Crow is lucky he didn't block that last Preki shot. Here's Preki again. The shot. A score off ground. Tied at one.
Preki showing why he's such a threat. The first shot that you were talking about with the left foot, if it does hit Crow, it embeds him into the goal post. The second one, he was to go to his right foot, but he was no less sure of himself. As we see the ball come to the right side, Preki with the left foot, double cut back to his right, which they're not expecting. It deflects out in front off of Rod Castro into the back of the goal. We'll see it from up above as the ball is played from Godfrey Ingram over to Preki, and Preki is able to work on Alex Golovnia one-on-one. And everybody expects him to go to his left, but now suddenly he goes to his right instead and unleashes a wicked drive off the defender into the goal.
It is Preki's goal right off Castro. Don't go away. Tied at one here in St. Louis.
Love those pumps down.
Excitement gets into your blood.
The Major Soccer League, where it roars indoors.
Preki, they've got the double team on. Somebody's got to be free. Right side, Ingram. Collins gets back in a hurry. Right back to Nogueira.
Collins may have been the player of the game in game four here in St. Louis on Thursday night. He did such a great job defensively and came forward very dangerously on many occasions.
Great move putting Collins to a defender this year. Normally he's been a midfielder and some up top maybe as a second forward. Here's Lukic. He'll shoot it and he scores!
Nogueira could not react in time, and it's tough to beat a goalkeeper like Nogueira at the near side.
Second playoff goal for Lukic, who played sparingly during the regular season this year and even more sparingly with Cleveland a year ago. Here's Guevara in the corner. St. Louis leads it 2-1. Too long. It'll find O'Quinn off the boards. Castro was trying to walk in on that. Doughty back for Quinn. Back for Doughty off a deflection. A shot. He scores off the far post. It's tied at two.
We mentioned Brian Quinn setting the tone. He orchestrates the entire attack when he's on the field. He gets the assist on that goal as he laid the ball on a one-touch pass, which he excels at, right out into Paul Doherty's run. It's played in from Doherty to Quinn, straight back immediately. Now he winds up not much to shoot at, but Doherty really found just that open couple inches over at the far post because Ilievski had everything else covered.
Only 5 feet 2 inches tall, but he's been a force for San Diego. Sixth goal of the playoffs, and the assist goes to Brian Quinn. It's his third goal in the last two games. He had two on Thursday. Here's Wright coming back. Here's where San Diego can be most explosive, right after they've scored one goal. Usually teams are vulnerable to giving one up.
Well, they excel also at high-pressure game. They'll try and keep St. Louis hemmed in until they can force a loose pass and turn it into a goal.
Castro back to Nogueira. A minute and a half to go in the opening quarter. Tied at two. Nogueira will wait, see if Dragicevic is going to force his hand. Nogueira will play it long. Fredrickson stopping that with a chest. Lifting it, Lukic, blocked by Carbonara. That was looking danger right in the face, the right foot of Lukic up high.
Well, we mentioned Nogueira's defensive abilities. Lowest goals against average in the regular season. And a stellar performer last year as a champion with the San Diego Sockers. But his distribution probably is better than just about anyone in the league because he can do it with the arm or with either foot.
And he's very confident out there. Makes few mistakes when he's out of his box area.
Good decisions in his distribution.
Duran giving it up now to Ingram. Back to Duran. Holding. Gave it up.
Drove. Wright heads into open space, but the pass, he had to wait for it. Wright still almost got by.
Strong recovery by Mark Fredrickson, who's had a tremendous year for the St. Louis Storm. A guy who never quits on a play. You know, that one, he chased all the way back and was able to beat Paul Wright to the line.
Knocking it back. A foul. As Lukic teed it up and it was blocked, the foul is called on San Diego.
Mark Fredrickson had a hat-trick, in fact, in the deciding game in the semifinal of the Western Division playoffs against the Tacoma Stars. So a defender who leads this team in blocks and is right up there at the top in terms of blocks in the entire league came up with some very important goals to send the St. Louis Storm into this Western Division Championship Series.
Second in career blocks to Bernie James. Fredrickson, 880 regular season block shots. Here's Ingram, ready to put it in play.
Plays it in front. Brown didn't get off a good shot. Great idea,
but he couldn't get around on it. It's cleared all the way deep towards Slovo Lievski. Wright trying to cause havoc. Slovo knocked it away to Marino.
Slovo Lievski, ever the risk taker.
Lukic in a corner. Brown holding it. Setting it across for Preki. Preki off the boards. Ingram, the shot blocked. Good block from Lattisour. And it's cleared out the other way. 7 seconds left. Slovo cleared it up for Clavijo. Clavijo, time will run out. That's it for the first quarter of play. 2-2 is your score after the first 15 minutes as we pause right now for this regional break. Taken down by Clavijo, and I guess they're even.
That's a payback, exactly. Clavijo knowing that the officials owed one to St. Louis. He doesn't have to worry too much about this being 2 minutes. If this is 2 minutes, obviously the one just before when Collins stood down Brecky would have also been 2 minutes.
Paul Wright was the leading scorer during the regular season against St. Louis this year. Did well against the Storm, but he did well against everybody. Here he comes. Cleared off the glass. Gabara settling it for Dougherty.
The turnaround, and he scores! Paul Dougherty, through a mass of confusion, gets the go-ahead goal.
He's so quick, and he's always buzzing around in there, and he has to because of his size. He's not going to be able to necessarily take up a position and hold it, but he can seize an opportunity when it does present itself. Look at him. He barely had a chance to turn around in a very tight space and still got that quick shot off on the turn. And the shot on the turn is difficult for goalkeepers to read. First of all, they don't necessarily expect it because just an instant before, the player was facing away from the goal. Now, a quick turn, there's a shot, and you're not really sure on what corner the guy might shoot at because he's still turning.
There just seemed to be some confusion out there, though, right in front of that Storm goal, and that split second may have cost St. Louis. Here's Brown. All the way across, Duran runs onto it. Duran nearing the corner. Lukic, great save, Nogueira. Boy, Lukic has really loosened up that right leg, brace it off. Schmetzer to Ingram. Ingram trying to turn, has Brown behind him. Terry Brown holding, blocked to Ingram, but a foul is called.
3-2 San Diego. It might be more, Ty, as Ron Newman tries to get a message across. It might be more, but Slovo has played some great soccer here. He's been tough. St. Louis, though, trying to make some things happen at the other end. There's a save by Nogueira. Just missing on the pass from Precky was Gino DeFlorio, but coming off his line well and anticipating was Victor Nogueira. We have a view of the situation from Nogueira. The ball by Schmetzer that just caught the crossbar as Nogueira caught a bit off his line, which he likes to do. He plays well out from his line, which is very effective for him, but every now and then he may get burned on that little blooper over the top.
Why do you think San Diego called a timeout at that stage?
I really think what they want to do is make sure that they stick another goal in before halftime. They want to bury the St. Louis Storm right now. Now, if they can do that one of two ways, as they've been doing. Since they're up by a goal, they could play slowly, try and draw St. Louis into their own end and burn them on a counterattack. And that's most likely will happen. Unless they go to the opposite thing, which they've also been doing from time to time, is just the high pressure in the St. Louis zone.
Golovnia sending it long towards Guevara against Duran. Guevara trying to shield it. Now it's Fredrickson. They collide, and a handball is called. It's 3-2 San Diego with 2 minutes to go here in the third, in the second quarter of play. And that one, and now it's Brian Quinn.
But San Diego is in control now. They don't want to lose their composure. They want to really consolidate themselves. Very critical these last minute and 40 seconds of the half.
Nogueira sending it ahead to Guevara. Blocked by Fredrickson. Neither he nor Guevara could find the handle of it. Now it's Crow, taken down by Ingram. This, to me, has been Kevin Crow's greatest year, and he's had great year after great year because all the experience left on defense. They lost Ralph Black, they lost Fernandez, Zoltan Toth, Cacho. It was Crow and rookies, pretty much.
He's helped stabilize them.
He really has, and he's had better offensive numbers as well, so he's taken chances, not just stayed back.
Kevin Crow, as we just saw a moment ago, so elegantly steps in front to beat his opponent to the ball. And then when he goes forward, he's very selective about it. If you see Kevin Crow go forward 80% of the time, you're going to see a goal from someone, not necessarily him, but he knows when the danger presents itself and how to take advantage of it.
Precky. Now to Donegan. Precky again against Paul Wright. Precky's pass looking for Ingram, blocked by Crow, and Crow will knock it away. 48 seconds to go in the first half of play.
And this is no slur on Ingram, but Thompson, you've seen a little bit stronger. May have been able to hold that ball even under the defensive pressure.
Off the boards, knocked away. Fredrickson, a shot, score, deflection! Tied again! But it was the Storm that came up with a goal with just seconds remaining, a Mark Fredrickson goal, a strange goal, a fluky goal, but they all count, and that one had to give St. Louis a lot of room as they went into the locker room at halftime.
Well, I think it does. It lifts their spirits, certainly. Even if they had gone down by just one goal, I think they would have accomplished what they wanted to, which is just to slow San Diego down enough. Now, San Diego has done quite a few things in their game very well, but I'm not sure if their mental approach is what Ron Newman was looking for. That fire is not there. They have a cushion. They're up game 3-1 in this series. And St. Louis had talked about trying to compensate for injuries, and you see a player like Bobo Lucic come up with a very important goal. You think that confidence might be a problem, or overconfidence in terms of San Diego? Because in talking to some of their players, they wanted to end it here tonight. They don't want to go back to San Diego. They'd like the time off.
It's one thing saying that, and it's another thing actually going out and doing it. Of course, everyone would like to go home and get this over with, but the other part of it is you better go out and be ready to fight tooth and nail, just like you did in some of the previous games. Can you reach back and really do it when you've got a team against you who's going to fight every bit of the way because their backs are really to the wall?
We're going to take you through the second quarter scoring summary and show you what took place. First of all, Paul Daugherty scored a goal from Jim Gabara. The time of that goal was at 2:35 of the second quarter, and for Daugherty, it ended up being his second goal of the game. And then Mark Fredrickson scored unassisted at 14:30, and as we talked about before, it was deflected off of Golovnia, and regardless of how they scored, it was a big one. But that goal, as much as it pumps up St. Louis, it could be a big wake-up call for San Diego.
I think so. They're going to go into the locker room, and they know there's 30 minutes of indoor soccer left, and they can turn it up a few notches, and they did in game four. There's no doubt about that. 7 unanswered goals. So for St. Louis, the challenge really is to see if they can't keep more or less the same pace of this game, the same type of rhythm to it, so that they can keep San Diego from catching fire as they did in game four.
We're going to switch from this game a little bit and talk about some defensive player of the year candidates sponsored by Jolly Rancher. Those are our defender of the year candidates in alphabetical order, and you'll notice that three of those players are playing in this game, starting with Clavijo, Pro, and Duran.
Well, we've seen the work of Clavijo and Duran for St. Louis in this game. Good attacking players when they come forward. We've mentioned, of course, Kevin Crowe, who's won that award 3 different times in his career. So he has to be a favorite, particularly if San Diego would continue to have the success in MSL playoff soccer that they've had in the past.
Yeah, you could certainly make a good case for any of those 5 candidates. Now let's take a look at who might be our MVP for the Major Soccer League, our Payday Most Valuable Player. And in that list of 5, we see, surprisingly, a goalkeeper there.
It is a bit different to see a goalkeeper. Normally, it's one of your top scorers, and goalkeepers are a little bit pushed to the wayside and may be up for their own awards. But Victor Noguera has been such a dominating force in this league for the San Diego Sockers, dominating statistically for goalkeepers all the way around the league. And he's a good offensive threat also. Zoran Karic, Cleveland Crunch having a great season all the way around. Brian Quinn, we're seeing his magic here tonight, too.
You know, you think about Noguera and you wonder, could they give it to a goalkeeper? But yet he started 28 straight games at one point. He had a great year, and he was the number one goalkeeper in the league, setting a record with 31 wins. We're at the end of the first half of play, even at 3 here in St. Louis.
Halftime at the St. Louis Arena in the Western final of the MSL playoffs between San Diego and St. Louis. And our guest at halftime is Bora Milutinovic, the new coach of the national team of the United States. And he has a very important project ahead of him to build towards the 1994 World Cup, which the United States will host. And he's trying to make us a world power in soccer. How difficult is that? And how important do you think your role will be in that?
Okay, coming here in San Luis to see the semifinal match. I'm very happy to be in San Luis. I'm coming to watch this match, to see some players. For me, it's very important to see many matches, many players, or after to make my team.
Do you think, in order to sell soccer to the American public, that you will have to change the style of play of the United States team?
I hope. I think for this is very important for me to see many matches, to see players. You have to start to play playing a little bit different. I think this is very important. But before, it's most important to see player, you know. Excuse me, my English is not very good. I started to learn maybe 2-3 weeks before. But I think it's maybe after 1-2 years, I have possibility to study to work with player.
What do you think of the indoor game? And do you think there are players in the Major Soccer League who will become candidates for your team?
Why not? You know, before in Yugoslavia, I play indoor. After in the season, I play the big football. I think it's not big difference. It's very important to know to play football, to have talent. After everything is easy.
Well, Bora, we know that you'll find the best players. You'll build the United States team into the type of success that you had with the Mexican team and with the Costa Rican team in the last 2 World Cups. We thank you for being our guest today. We'll be back in just a moment with highlights and stats from the first half from the St. Louis Arena. This is MSL Soccer on Sports Channel America.
And right now it's time to pause for this regional break. For Crow, and a
hops into the seats out of play. It'll give the Soccer's penalty-killing unit a well-deserved rest, and for that matter, the Storm power play unit, if Don Popovic wants to keep some of those players still out there.
Another couple looks at the saves by Nogueira. The ball driven across by Ingram. It's out in front. It's missettled, really, by Quinn. And the shot by DeFlorio is a great stop by Nogueira. The second one really just hits Nogueira at the near post. Almost went off the boards, his legs, and then into the goal.
But you talked about what Nogueira does so well. He gets back up for the second shot. He was in position. Hit him or saves it, doesn't matter. He was in position. Here's Duran across, and Quinn knocked it away. Quinn beating his man Preki. He's got way to the right. Trying to play it across, deflects away, and he scores! Short-handed goal! But Quinn set him up. A killer goal for San Diego.
And a couple bad breaks in the entire sequence, really, for the St. Louis team, because Quinn did lead the rush, but it looked like he was not able to get that initial pass through. It was actually blocked, but it came back to his own foot. And he gets, here's the first one that's blocked, and really bad luck for St. Louis. It bounces off of Duran again to Wes Wade, who can fly with anybody. He's probably the fastest player in the league, except for perhaps his line mate. All right, and he's able to slot it through Ilyevsky's legs. But at that point, Ilyevsky doesn't have much of a chance. He's trying to cut the angle. Wade is flying onto that loose ball, and it's just unfortunate for St. Louis that bounce, that rebound off of Duran's leg went directly into the run of Wes Wade.
Wade, 9 goals last year, 21 this regular season. Here's DeFlorio, still in the power play, remember. He almost got it back. 8 seconds left on the man advantage. Here's power play.
Preki, one of the best players in this league that I've seen, to follow his own rebounds. He has a sense of where they're going to be.
Quinn. Lots of times there is no rebound. It's in the back of the net.
That's true, too.
Quinn cutting it to Collins. Collins, a shot deflected in! San Diego scored with time running out on the power play. They lead it 5-3, and I'll have to check that out. That was a quick deflection. I saw Duran in front, and I also saw San Diego
player. It hit Duran. You could tell by the grimace on his face. We see the ball cut across by Quinn, and it's done well enough so that Collins can look up and take the left-footed drive. It hits Duran out in front. Ilyevsky going the wrong way. He's got no chance. We'll see from the other angle. It's got a lot of velocity on it, so all Duran could do is put out his leg. He doesn't get enough of the ball to keep it out. Instead, he puts it past his own goalkeeper, and there's not much either one of them could do on that situation. Give the credit, really, for Quinn to get the ball out to Collins to be able to line up that good of a left-footed shot.
Ben Collins gets it from Brian Quinn, and Collins, you know, has 5 goals in his playoff series. He has been magnificent. Time of the goal, 10 minutes and 47 seconds, and we'll see, is that an official power play? Muir was just about coming out of the box, so we'll check that out for you. But in effect, whether it is or it isn't, well, we'll come back to that. First of all, a reminder once again, that Major Soccer League media guide still available by sending $15 check or money order to the address on your screen, or just get in touch with the Major Soccer League office by phone. They'll give you the details. Dragicevic now, as we're back on the live action, out to Muir, and he put it upstairs. What I was going to say before is, if it's not a power play goal, it's still in effect a man advantage, because Muir never came out and was part of the play.
No, he's not a factor in the play at all. And I think the biggest factor in that play and in the previous goal is just 2 bad breaks for the St. Louis Storm. The deflections, rebounding in favor of the San Diego Sockers. But when it comes down to it, you do make your own breaks. They had the guys in the right places to make it happen. And that is a sign of a team that could be successful, and particularly in the playoffs. If you can get out there and you get it, anytime you win a championship, you need some luck. But if you can force that luck in your favor, then you're going to go places.
It is not a power play goal. High foot from Clavijo. Not a power play goal, but for all intents and purposes, there was indeed a man advantage. Muir came out right at the end, and he basically watched that ball go into the back.
You talk about Kevin Crowe, he's from Northern California.
Here's Duran. Right across to Nogueira. That one stunk. Duran got some good speed and spin on that one. Nogueira will give it up now to Brian Quinn. Quinn holding it. He's been a key in this one, like he has been in every game with San Diego. Preki,
what skill, huh? Bring that ball down from that height right between 2 opposing players.
Sometimes it's like watching a clinic when you see Preki out there.
That's it. The horn ends at the end of 3 quarters of play. The Sockers right now in the driver's seat, but the Storm still have 15 minutes to try and continue their season.
Over the Kansas City Comets.
Here's Ingram. Holding it. To Duran. Duran. chasing it down. Great play by Wright, walking it up slow-mo. And he ran out of room. Still with it to Doherty. The hat trick for Paul Doherty. San Diego doubling the Storm 6-3.
Paul Wright with his immense speed just streaked back past the St. Louis defense. And really had a shot that he could have taken. You'll see him here get past Smetzer. Smetzer now just chasing from behind. And there's a fake there. Slobo held him pretty well. And it looked like the attack was over here. A good call by the officials here by not calling that foul on Smetzer, letting the advantage play on. Doherty finishing it. And Castro started it, putting it into the space. Smetzer was worried about Castro. He didn't see Paul Wright streaking over his left shoulder. There's Paul Wright. Appeared to be wasting a chance there, but still got the ball out in front to Doherty, who just stroked it away with that left foot.
Doherty trying very hard to be the most valuable player in the Major Soccer League playoffs. Off to a great start here with his eighth goal, and it is the hat trick for Mr. Doherty. Here's Hermes. Juan Hermes has had a quiet night, but with San Diego, I mean, the other night, 12 different players figured in the scoring. One guy sometimes has a great night, sometimes some of the big guns do nothing, and the goals can... seconds after San Diego scored what might very well have been the goal that really broke the backs of the Storm. And now, not necessarily, it's a two-goal game.
There's some new life for the St. Louis Storm. Two goals is not very much in indoor soccer.
Right, becoming a U.S. citizen. All the way back now to Nogueira. The head on the right side, Wright just came on a change. Paul Wright, the shot, he scores on the far side. Again, it's that San Diego switch.
How about the San Diego swagger after the goal? He struck it really well. And San Diego, as you mentioned, making the change as the play developed, getting Paul Wright onto the field at the most opportune moment. It's something that the Newman really revolutionized this sport with. Paul Wright stepping onto the field. Now he's got so much time and space to really line up the shot, and boy, does he get a hold of it. He sends it to the opposite side netting, just overpowering Slobolievsky, and he's ready to head back. He's not going to Disneyland. He's going to San Diego.
He's got to find a new choreographer, though. That wasn't too good. His third playoff goal. The thing about Wright, though, when you make that change, obviously you get the full length of the bench for the advantage, but when you put the league's fastest player out there, plus that's a nightmare.
Yeah, plus he gets that 30-foot head start by jumping on from the end of the bench, yeah.
For a defense, it's a nightmare.
Yeah, just when you think you've got somebody tracked down, there's a guy behind you, and he's one you're never going
to start to come back. St. Louis had momentum at that point, and power play. They could have gone up themselves. But that's the kind of switch you can have. You take momentum away from one side, you give it to the other. 30 seconds left on the Storm season. The Sockers will live on for another playoff, the championship round against the winner of Cleveland, Kansas City. Banks sending it in. Clavijo off the boards. Duran. 18 seconds left.
Schmetzer gave it back, and he didn't know Clavijo left. It didn't go in. Now the goal line went on.
With 13 seconds, and the referee says no.
He waved it off. He thought he had just as good a look at it as the goal judge.
Dragicevic, right side. Ingram powers it upstairs. And out of play.
But when you think about it, just a couple bad breaks for St. Louis after they had tied this game up and played very well in the early third quarter. We have another look at this. Does it go in? It's not in. It hits the post. There it's not in. It's starting to roll. And it's awfully close.
You make the call.
My
guess is that it wasn't, but you can't get much closer than that. And Herb Silva, well, I don't know, seeing it backwards, it may have been in. You see it roll all the way. The entire ball must clear the entire line. It's academic, though, folks, at this point. 4 seconds left. San Diego up by 3 goals. They're into the championship final.
Not a lot of people here, but 6,000 plus are on their feet because they know that the Storm gave them a great season. But San Diego wins this series 7-4. The Storm here comes to a close.
Ron Newman, a gentleman in victory here, shaking hands. And his team here in this game were good enough to take advantage of a couple of bad breaks that broke against the St. Louis Storm. The Storm could have been a little more fortunate, but when you're up against San Diego, if just one or two breaks go against you, you've got no chance. You need those breaks in your favor.
Great effort by the Storm, but San Diego wins it 7-4.